Hello and welcome to another video. In this video, I'm going to talk about the basics of cell biology. We're going to talk about the properties of the eukaryotic cell. I'm also going to talk about the differences between the eukaryotic cell and the prokaryotic cell. And I'm also going to talk about the basics of histology, where I'm going to take you through the journey of how tissue in the human body ends up looking like this. So over many years, we've been looking at cells through simple light microscopes, just like the one you see right here. So if we take a quick look into the history of histology, there has been a lot of people that have contributed to the development of microscope. But histology really started with Robert Hooke and Marcello Malpighi, who in the year 1700 were the first people who used the term cell. They used this simple light microscope you see right here. And how did they work? Well, they used candle, just like this one. This is they used this as a source of light because they didn't have any electricity at that time, and they used this glass bulb filled with water to focus the light into a specimen, something they wanted to observe, and then that light would then reflect it into this microscope, where they had different lenses to magnify this image, and with those lenses they could actually see the cells of the specimen they're looking at. So here's what they looked at. This is a bark tissue from a tree called cork oak. So this is a plant eukaryotic cell, and each black spot are going to represent one eukaryotic cell. So in histology, in order to understand the differences between tissues, in order to understand the differences between nervous and muscle tissues, for example, you need to understand the different cellular characteristics. So I'm not going to go too much in details under this because that's going to be for other videos, but mainly the first thing you want to look at when you look at tissues like that is what cells are you looking at? What are their functions? Here I've used three muscle tissues as an example. Here you see the skeletal muscles, and here the cardiac muscles and smooth muscles. So what cells are you looking at? What are their functions? Well, you know that muscle tissues need to apply force, so they're movable. So how do you differentiate between them even though they have the same function? Well, you know that skeletal muscles are going to be long and cylindrical, just like you see here. Cardiac muscles are going to be short and branched. So these muscles, for example, is formed like that. While this muscle cell is formed like that. While smooth muscles are going to be very narrow and elongated. So that all going to be very close to each other. So you need to look at the shape of the cells, but you also need to look at the cell nucleus. So you know that the skeletal muscles are going to be multinucleated. They're going to have many nuclei, just like you see here. While cardiac muscles are going to have one nucleus. No, the same goes to smooth muscles, only one nucleus. And you also need to look at the shape of the nucleus as well, because only by looking at these three pictures, you can already tell that the nucleus are shaped differently. And you can also see that when I start talking about the epithelial tissue in other videos. So you need to understand what cells you're looking at and their shape. Another thing you want to look at is, you know those alternating black and white stripes you see in the skeletal muscles and cardiac muscles? Smooth muscle doesn't have that. That's why it's called smooth. So that's just one example of how to differentiate between cells in histology. So just to go through some basic properties of a cell, you know that cells have genetic materials, that's just like you see here, that's going to be the purple in one cell. And they also reproduce, like mitosis and meiosis. This is a picture of cell division, reproduction. And cells obtain and produce energy, and are also capable of metabolism. So when you eat food, they're digested, and then they're used to produce energy. And cells are also capable of transporting materials. Here I've used exocytosis and endocytosis as an example. Here the cell uses vesicles to transport a lot of materials outside and inside the cell. So that's two examples of cell transporting materials. Another function cells can do is respond to stimuli. So if you ever hold your hand above candle, what's going to happen is that pain receptors on cells are going to be stimulated. That's going to send a signal to the central nervous system. That's where you're going to feel the pain. That's why it takes a little time before you feel the pain of heat. And what's going to happen is that they're going to send a signal to your muscle to remove the arm. That's going to be one example of cells responding to stimuli. Another thing cells are capable of is self-regulations, and an example of that is apoptosis. So if a cell notices that something is wrong with it, It can, it ha actually has the ability to kill itself so that it doesn't reproduce that mistake all the time. There are going to be some differences between prokaryotic cells and eukaryotic cells as well. So eukaryotic cells has a cell nucleus, prokaryotic cells doesn't have that. They have something called nucleoid, which is just a thin membrane that doesn't really separate it from the cytoplasm. Eukaryotic cells are really complex cells. They have what is called membrane-bound organelles, where most of the organelles in the eukaryotic cells are going to have membranes. Prokaryotic cells doesn't have that. And their ribosomes in eukaryotic cells are also going to be bigger, and they're going to have more RNA materials. So there are going to be a lot of differences between the eukaryotic and prokaryotic cells, but the main difference I wanted to highlight is the size difference between them. In this picture, you can kind of see the differences in size of the eukaryotic and prokaryotic cells. So prokaryotic cells are usually going to be between 1 to 5 micrometers big, while the eukaryotic cells are going to be everything between 10 and 100 micrometers, and it's a really big difference between them. So if we go over to microscopes, there are going to be three main components for a microscope to work. You just need a source of light, just like you see here. I need a specimen to observe. It's going to be this one, the tissue slides. And also need a system of lenses to focus the light on the specimen and enlarge it. So we mainly have two types of microscopes. We have light microscopes and we have electron microscopes. In light microscopes, you're going to use lamp and lenses to focus the light on a specimen and enlarge it. While in electron microscopes, you're going to use magnets to focus the electrons on a specimen. So in transmission electron microscopes, the electrons are going to go through the specimen and then detect it. While in scanning electron microscopes, here the electrons are going to go down, and then you have electron detector, which is going to detect the electrons that bounces off the specimen. So electrons going to go down this way and then bounce off the specimen and then detect it. So in light microscopes, we're mainly going to have four methods of looking at cells. We're going to have Brightfield microscope, which is the most frequently used microscope in histology. You get pictures just like that with white background. And you also have phase contrast microscope, where you see the contrast between the different organelles in the cell. Here you can see a cell under division. I believe this is telophase, because you can see the chromosomes on either side of the cell. And you also have darkfield microscope, which is going to be opposite of brightfield microscope. This one's going to have black background and light and white cells. And you also have fluorescence microscope. This is my favorite because this one uses fluorescence, uses antibodies to sit on the cell and then use fluorescence and then detects it. And you can see beautiful pictures like this one. So that's light microscope. If you go over to electron microscopes are going to be more specific. They're going to look at cells in more detailed view, and they're going to zoom in even more. You can, in transmission electron microscopes, you're able to actually see the organelles as you see here. So if you go over to scanning electron microscopes, here the electrons comes down and bounces off the specimen and then detected on a an electron detector, and that forms an image of the specimen. Here you can see a cross-section of a leaf, and you can see the cells inside of it as well. So how do we get those slides? Where do we get them from? Well, first, the patient goes to the doctor where the tissue is removed, and that removed tissue is called a biopsy. And the biopsy is then sent to a pathological laboratory for fixation. And fixation is an extremely important step because fixation kills the tissue so that destruction of the cells is prevented. And fixation also keeps tissue as close to its natural state as possible by forming those crossed links in protein, just like you see here. There are a lot of different ways to fixate the tissue, but the most frequently used is formalin, as you see here. After fixation, you need to remove the water from the inside to replace it with a wax solvent like paraffin. And here you need to take it through gradually increasing alcohol so that all the water can be diffused out. So after removing water, you need to dip it in paraffin actually, which is the same material as you will find in candle. This is how we do it in a laboratory I work in. We just take the tissue and dip it in paraffin, and then we'll get what is called tissue blocks, which actually will stay like that forever. You then need to cut the tissue block using a microtome and place it on a glass slide, just like that. After that, you need to color it. And hematoxylin and eosin, or H and E, we call them, is the most frequently used coloring method. Here, the hematoxylin binds substances with negative charge, just like the phosphor groups in DNA and RNA, while eosin binds substances with positive charge, just like the amino acids in the cytoplasm in the cells. And here in this picture, you can kind of see the differences here. The hematoxylin stains acidic structures blue, just like the DNA. And the eosin stains basic structures pink, just like the amino acids. So in histology, we mainly divide the tissues into four groups. You have the nervous tissue, epithelial tissue, muscle tissue, and connective tissue. And in my next histology videos, I'm going to try to show how we can differentiate and recognize the cells through microscopes.